commission was set up not to sit in judgment, because that is the task of the constitutionally appointed judges, but to investigate the fate of the people who disappeared during those ill-omened years of our nation's life. However, after collecting several thousand statements and testimonies verifying or establishing the existence of hundreds of secret detention centers and compiling over 50,000 pages of documentation, we are convinced that the recent military dictatorship brought about the greatest and most savage tragedy in the history of Argentina. Although it must be justice which has the final word, we cannot remain silent in the face of all that we have heard, read, and reported. This went far beyond what might be considered criminal offenses and takes us into the shadowy realm of crimes against humanity. Through the technique of disappearance and its consequences, all the ethical principles which the great religions and the noblest philosophies have evolved through centuries of suffering and calamity have been trampled underfoot, barbarously ignored. Throughout the ages, there have been many pronouncements on the sanctity of individual rights. In modern times, these have ranged from the rights enshrined in the French Revolution to those expressed in the Universal Declarations of Human Rights and the great encyclicals of this century. Every civilized nation, including our own, has laid down in its constitution guarantees which can never be suspended, even in the most catastrophic state of emergency. The right of life, the right to security of person, the right to a trial, the right not to suffer either inhuman conditions of detention, denial of justice, or summary execution. From the huge amount of documentation we have gathered, it can be seen that these human rights were violated at all levels by the Argentine state during the repression carried out by its armed forces, nor were they violated in a haphazard fashion, but systematically, according to a similar pattern, with identical kidnappings and tortures taking place throughout the country. How can one speak of individual excesses? The information we collected confirms that this diabolical technology was employed by people who may well have been sadists, but who were carrying out orders. If our own conclusions seem insufficient in this respect, further proof is furnished by the farewell speech given to the Inter-American Defense Junta on the 24th of January 1980 by General Santiago Omar Riveros, head of the Argentine delegation. Quote, "We wage this war with our doctrine in our hands, with the written orders of each high command," end quote. Those members of the Argentine military juntas who replied to the universal outcry at the horror by deploring, quote, "excesses in the repression which are inevitable in a dirty war," end quote, were hypocritically trying to shift the blame for this calculated terror onto the individual actions of less senior officers. The abductions were precisely organized operations, sometimes occurring at the victim's place of work, sometimes in the street in broad daylight. They involved the open deployment of military personnel who were given a free hand by the local police stations. When a victim was sought out in his or her home at night, armed units would surround the block and force their way in. A feeling of complete vulnerability spread throughout Argentine society, coupled with the fear that anyone, however innocent, might become a victim of the never-ending witch hunt. Some people reacted with alarm, others tended consciously or unconsciously to justify the horror. "There must be some reason for it," they would whisper, as though trying to propitiate awesome and inscrutable gods, regarding the children or parents of the disappeared as plague bearers. Yet such feelings could never be wholehearted, as so many cases were known of people who had been sucked into that bottomless pit who were obviously not guilty of anything. From the moment of their abduction, the victims lost all rights, deprived of all communication with the outside world, held in unknown places, subjected to barbaric tortures, kept ignorant of their immediate or ultimate fate. They risked being either thrown into a river or the sea, weighed down with blocks of cement, or burned to ashes. They were not mere objects, however, and still possess all the human attributes. They could feel pain, could remember a mother, child, or spouse, could feel infinite shame at being raped in public. They were people not only possessed of this sense of boundless anguish and fear, but also, and perhaps indeed because of feelings such as these, they were people who, in some corner of their soul, clung to an absurd notion of hope. We have discovered close to 9,000 of these unfortunate people who were abandoned by the world. We have reason to believe that the true figure is much higher. Many families were reluctant to report a disappearance for fear of reprisals. Some still hesitate, fearing the resurgence of these evil forces. It is with sadness and sorrow that we have carried out the mission entrusted to us by the Constitutional President of the Republic. It has been an extremely arduous task, for we had to piece together a shadowy jigsaw years after the events had taken place, when all the clues had been deliberately destroyed, all documentary evidence burned, and buildings demolished. The basis for our work has been the statements made by relatives or by those who managed to escape from this hell, or even the testimonies of people who were involved in the repression, but who, for whatever obscure motives, approached us to tell us what they knew. investigations, we have been insulted and threatened by the very people who committed these crimes. Far from expressing any repentance, they continued to repeat the old excuses that they were engaged in a dirty war or that they were saving the country and its Western Christian values, when in reality, they were responsible for dragging those values inside the bloody walls of the dungeons of repression. They accuse us of hindering national reconciliation, of stirring up hatred and resentment, of not allowing the past to be forgotten. This is not the case. We have not acted out of any feeling of vindictiveness or vengeance. All we are asking for is truth and justice, in the same way that the churches of different denominations have done, in the understanding that there can be no true reconciliation until the guilty repent and we have justice based on truth. If this does not happen, then the transcendent mission which the judicial power fulfills in all civilized communities will prove completely valueless. Truth and justice, it should be remembered, will allow the innocent members of the armed forces to live with honor. Otherwise, they risk being besmirched by an unjust, all-embracing condemnation. Truth and justice will permit the armed forces as a whole to see themselves once more as the true descendants of those armies which fought so heroically, despite their lack of means, to bring freedom to half a continent. Which have shaken our nation in recent years and have remained silent about the terrorism which occurred prior to March 1976, or even in a torturous way of presenting an apology for it. On the contrary, our commission has always repudiated that terror, and we are glad to take this opportunity to do so again here. It was not our task to look into the crimes committed by those terrorists, but simply to investigate the fate of the disappeared, whoever they were, and from whichever side of the violence they came. Great catastrophes are always instructive. The tragedy which began with the military dictatorship in March 1976, the most terrible our nation has ever suffered, will undoubtedly serve to help us understand that it is only democracy which can save a people from horror on this scale. Argentina, so sadly infamous throughout the world, be repeated in our nation. Ernesto Sabato, September 20th, 1984, Buenos Aires, Argentina.